Okay. Want to answer some questions?
Let's go. Let's go.
Okay. This is Teresa, who says, my kid was acting out, so naturally I smacked him. I told my sister about it, who told me that the Bible says we should, quote, spare the rod and spoil the child. What do you think?
We should spare the rod. I don't think it's, first of all, that's not the Bible. I think that's one more quote from poor Richard's almanac. You know, the wisdom of Ben Franklin has permeated our society. The Bible says folly is bound up in the heart of a child, and the rod of reproof drives it far from him. And, you know, children need a certain amount of discipline. And I know in our political correct culture, we just think that's terrible. You know, we'll let them go to jail, we'll let them smoke grass, we'll let them do all these things. But in terms of the discipline they need to grow into mature adults, we want to withhold that from them. And the Bible, there's nothing in there but sparing the rod and spoiling the child. If you say it that way and say it right, that comports with what the Bible says. If you spare the rod, you will spoil the child. All right, what's next?
Okay, this is James, who says, I love this girl in school, but she doesn't love me. I've tried to forget her, but I can't. Can you please give me a biblical perspective as to what I should do?
I don't know any biblical perspective, but there's some songs about puppy love you might be listening to when you're in school, when you're in high school.
He doesn't say how old he is. He just says in school. So he could be a college guy, you know, and really desperately in love with someone, you know.
He'll get over it. All right, I don't know what...
James, we feel your pain.
Yeah.
No, really, I
Sorry,
mean, that is so
buddy.
Much angst. You know, you really need to find some good, solid friends and refocus.
Get over it. All right.
This is Jennifer, who says, my friend thought she saw an image of Jesus in the clouds. She says it's a sign. What do you think?
A lot of people have seen that. You know, there was that picture they took. You know, there was some mud and snow and stuff, and somebody's walking along, and the Lord said, take a picture. So they took a picture. And here was this sort of like Rorschach test that all this ink blot. And if you looked at it one way, you could see an image of Jesus. And I was teaching a class of college students in Queens, and they, of course, thought that I had to be their teacher. I had to be spiritual. They showed me this thing. I didn't see anything. They said, don't you see it? I said, no, I don't see it.
I think that might be a cloud formation.
Yeah, have you seen it?
Could be wrong.
But, you know, when you look at it finally, you do see it.
Yeah.
But it's not a test of spirituality. And, yeah, there might be something in the cloud, but I don't think it's a sign. But, you know, the Lord may be speaking to you and lifting your spirit, and you see the glory of the Lord, and you can praise God because of his creation. There's nothing wrong with that. That's good. Okay.
This is Diane, who says, I have three adult children who all hate me. I can't really blame them. I didn't become a Christian until recently, and I made mistakes along the way. I've tried to apologize and reconcile with my family, but they want nothing to do with me. What should I do?
I think you should continue to love them, continue to show love to them, and continue to live your life. And you pray for them and know that sooner or later God will bring reconciliation, because God's on the side of healing and of reconciliation. And but there's nothing you can do right now except just continue to love them and just say, look, I love you. You're my children. I was a bad parent. I ask your apologies. Please forgive me. And if you won't forgive me, you know, live your life and God bless you.
You know, sometimes it's not a bad idea to write a letter with all of that in it, too, because that stays, you know,
sure.
They can
reread
it.
I presume that had been done, but maybe not. All right.
Okay, this is Alan, who says, why does it seem that God only comes to a person when a person is near rock bottom or about to die? Do we all have to be that bad off before God will come to us?
He's there all the time. God, you know, in him we live and move and have our being. He's everywhere. But we don't seek him until we're desperate. You know, others, I'm desperate for you. You know, I'm desperate for you. And you will seek for me and find me when you seek for me with all your heart. That's why he comes with people in a moment of extremism, because that's when we really are desperate. And I know what that's like. I mean, I was desperate. I was crying out to God, God, I've got to have an answer. When you get that way, then all of a sudden things start happening. What's up?
This is John, who says, you've warned Christians against communicating with the dead, but when Moses and Elijah appeared on the Mount of Transfiguration, was that not communicating with the dead?
Well, they weren't dead at the time. They were alive. I just don't think Jesus was up there having a seance. you know, they showed up. And they were representative of the Old Testament, and I mean the law and the prophets. That's what it was. And he was, and God was saying to them, "This is my son. Listen to him." It's all the time we've got. Thank you for being with us.